perhaps. Let me see. Oh, hi, whoever's just joined us. Well, one thing is, it's a really nice day. Just a shame that we're all stuck in. Oh, hi, Katrina. Hope you're well. You're staying safe. Right, Rebs. Okay, so we've got a few just popped on now. So if you want to say hi, just pop say hello in the comments, and then we'll get started. Because what I'm going to do is I'm filming this, and it's going to be put up onto the YouTube channel anyway, so that anyone who isn't able to make it can just go and re-catch up and just have another look at what we're going through today. So the point of today is really to talk about puppy socialisation, and then just some general guidance on enrichment and what you can do while we're in a lockdown situation. So I think most of you have probably seen my garden by now, and it's quite a nice area for dogs, so we're not too short on what we do for enrichment. So Halvan, hi there, how are you? And I think what we can say is that, you know, we can keep them occupied in many, many ways. But I think we'll deal with the enrichment side a little bit later on. But for now, we'll talk about, try and stay out of the sunlight. We'll try and talk about puppy, if you have got a new puppy. And also if you were going to have a puppy, and obviously it's still at the breeders because you can't go and get it. So one of the most important phases in a dog's life is this period that we call the socialisation period. It has been called the critical phase, and it's at a period around there's lots of different studies, but anything from 3 weeks to 16 weeks, and that's kind of the prime period for what we call socialisation and habituation. Just a quick reminder, if you can hear me okay, just let me know. So I've been testing out a new mic, so hopefully this is a little bit better as I move away from the camera. You should be able to hear me okay. So 3 to 16 weeks is important. You normally get your puppy at around about 8 weeks. So that really gives you another 8 weeks to try and cram so much in, including vaccinations. Well, the vets aren't doing routine vaccinations at the moment. So depending when that all comes available, you could be outside that window. But does that all doom and gloom? No, of course it's not. There is so much we can do. Lissy, there is so much that we can do to habituate your pup to the world, to get them used to everything and enjoying life. Okay. Oh, thanks, Katrina. So what we really want to be able to do is just effectively expose them. When you look up socialization sort of as a definition, I mean, yes, in the English dictionary it'll talk about interaction with, but from a behavioral sense, what we actually want is exposure to. So we just want the dogs to get used to things. So there are many, many things we can do with that. We can go onto YouTube, we can hold the dog in the window and watch the world go by. We can sit on our front doorstep with the dog, so we can expose them to all the things that we are worried about. And actually, for me, I think we're going to end up with, particularly in this period, if you have got a puppy, you could end up with a better behaved dog. Because one of the things that we do wrong a lot of the time is we take our puppy out and just give them this massive kind of full-on experience, and they're meeting dogs, they're meeting people, they're coming into contact with cars, they're going to parks, and it's just overload, it's just sensory overload. And sometimes that's what's creating this buildup of hyperexcitability, even fear. So actually, by having it more controlled, you may find that your puppy is able to deal with things much better. That said, we do need to build in some exposure to the stressful environment. So I think there was a study by one of my mentors, Tom Mitchell, who looked at sound, and they found that one exposure to fireworks at a low level in the first weeks of life, from 3 to 16 weeks, would effectively protect your dog from ever being fearful of fireworks. So just playing the sound of fireworks between 3 and 16 weeks can protect your dog from ever becoming fearful of fireworks. I mean, that is an amazing finding, okay? Doesn't mean that something won't happen in the future that links to a firework and gives them a different type of fear, but in terms of that, that's why this period is so important. So for me, what can you do? Okay, so no vaccinations. Can you take your dog out? Well, for me, yes. Okay, can you take your dog out? I'm just checking. I thought I'd got something stuck on the camera. So can you take your dog out? Yes. Now, there is lots of caveats with that. Is they cannot be put on the ground in areas that you do not know. So if a dog has weed up a lamppost, you know, you don't want your unvaccinated dog going up to there, because you have no idea what that dog has or anything to do with that, okay? So what we need to do is carry the dog where possible, and as they're small puppies, even the bigger dogs, you can carry them around with you. You can still go on your exercise walk and get them exposed to the few cars that are around. And again, because there's fewer traffic, it doesn't get as scary, because it's one every so often. So it's actually a really good time to do some socialization with your puppy, but just do it in a controlled manner. So you can, if you've had a child and you've got a pusher, you can pop them in that. You can take them around with you. YouTube is a fantastic source for all these things. I mean, you know, just the other day I was filming a new course and I was using YouTube to play a gravel path sound. So that's just somebody walking along a gravel path, and I can then just reward my dog. Now, what you want to do is, when your puppy is getting exposed to these things, is not get too overexcited with them in terms of going, oh, you know, this is really good, that's great. Stay calm and just actually just go, oh yeah, that's good. Keep yourself very calm. Yes, good girl. You know, and just keep it nice and calm, because what we're looking for is, we're looking for calmness. We're looking for effectively no reaction. So as you walk around and they get exposed to things, we want to be using their ordinary kibble, or ordinary, if you, depending on what you're feeding them on. Obviously, if it's kibble moistened, just, you know, maybe use a spoon and just take that out with you. And just make sure you're rewarding them heavily for coming into interaction with all these items and new things, but do it in a very calm way. If you find that they're showing any fear, you just need to take a step back, give them a bit more distance, and then just carry on feeding them through it. So in the house, use a lot of different surfaces. Okay, so get them walking on carpet, astroturf. Not that you've got astroturf in your house, but if you've got a bit of astroturf, you know, get them walking over that. If you've got some packaging, bubble wrap, get them walking over that. Sandpaper, laminate flooring, lino, all different surfaces. Get them walking in the bath, you know, get them walking on lots of different surfaces. I've got some things up here that I'm going to run through and show you later. I think I've left one bag up there, but there's a foam cushion on here. If I just move this around, there's a foam cushion covered in plastic, you know, just a different surface. So just a lot of things that you can just get them walking into, touching, experiencing, and it's just building their confidence. That's probably something that is key out of everything to do with socialization and habituation, is confidence. I would rather in this time you spent the most amount of time you can in building your dog's confidence. If you can build your dog's confidence and their kind of optimism to look at things in a more favorable way than being nervous about it, that will safeguard you amongst many, many things. You may worry that, well, my dog's not going to get out and see lots of dogs. They don't need to. They know they're a dog, Okay, there have been many, many studies done, and one study where a dog actually was taken away from its mum at the normal age and was pretty much living a solitary life. Then when it came across dogs, just interacted with them normally because it knew it was a dog. This rush to push them into these flooding environments where they're exposed to so much, you know, is effectively not really helpful, and it just generates too much overexcitement. Because what we want them to be able to do is to look at everything in our world and just go, okay, yeah, I know what that is, and just move on. That's what we want, okay? So don't panic that if you have got a puppy and you can't get the vaccinations done, that you can't get them socialized. As I say, you can't put them on ground in unfamiliar areas. If you know the area and you know, I mean, the roads are quiet, and if you live on a side street, yeah, I mean, you could put them on the ground in the middle of the road, because it's highly unlikely that many dogs have walked down the middle of the road and weed on it and put anything on there that's too bad. But if you monitor everything, but you're only looking at short exposure. But for me, Bliss didn't have her second vaccinations done until she was 15 weeks old. But, oh, she was out everywhere with me. She was carried, she was protected, she was safeguarded, but she was experiencing everything that I could think of. I carried her into large shops. I carried her to a train station. You know, she went and she got exposed to as much as I possibly could over those weeks that I had her. And she's turned out to be a fairly robust, confident little dog. So it's not imperative. So don't panic. Please don't panic that, you know, you're gonna miss an opportunity. But confidence games are just so, so important. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and move into our little arena and just maybe start showing you some of the games that you can play. I mean, Bliss is now, I think she's probably 9.5 months old. So still a puppy, but she can do so much. So, you know, she's pretty confident. I mean, today I was out on a walk with her and I was doing some scent work, and I hid the scent tin a little bit too high up in the tree. And she was just trying to jump up into this tree to get to where this scent tin was, and nothing was putting her off. So I was like, oh, you know, great idea, John, put it out of reach for her. So if you've got any questions, obviously just pop them in the comments below. And if you're watching this sort of later on the YouTube channel, then either message me on my Facebook page or just add a comment below the YouTube video and I will get back to you. But don't panic, okay? Use the TV. You can go on to, you know, these vets programs, so you can play the TV with dogs on there. And most TV programs today are filmed in enough quality that the picture that is being broadcast, the dog will see it as a dog. A long time ago, the TV programs weren't good enough, so the picture would actually seem like a flickering image to a dog. So, but today, that's much better quality. So again, you can play the sound, you can play dogs barking. I say, just go onto YouTube, put in dog barking sounds, cats meowing sounds, cow mooing sounds, just play them as much as you can. There's CDs available, but you can, I say, YouTube's a great source because everything is pretty much free. So you just play it, you know, reward your dog. When they just sit down, do nothing, reward your dog. Just keep them getting used to it. So a couple of games. So I'm just going to spin the camera around, so just bear with me a second. Just swap that around, you don't want to see my, so there we go. Just move that. Hopefully you can see that okay. So a couple of things that I like is just random objects. So what we can start with is just, let me just move these out of the way. Cans is noise box is one of my favorite games because it's just a way to get the dog sort of exploring. So it's just an empty box on the floor. Oh, good girl. And drop some food in. Now I'm doing this with two dogs out here. I'd probably suggest that you might want to do one at a time if you have got multiple dog household, but it's just dropping food in. These two are quite happy together with the food, and the box will move, and as the dogs get more confident. When I started this with Bliss, if that box moves, she'd be jumping out. So, good girl. Right, I'm just going to check to make sure that everything's in view on the camera. Cool. There we go. So once they're happily going into the box, just as a normal occurrence, we just start adding things. Now, what I will say is I'm adding a Coke can. Yes, please. But be very careful with cans because they're made a bit flimsy today, so you can put some tape around them. But you just pop one in and just drop some food. And now the box moves and it makes noise. But the dogs are staying in because we're putting their, I'm going to say food, this is their breakfast. Okay, I'm using their breakfast to feed them in this way. Then you can add a few more cans. And then we just and you can probably just see there that it's making noise. Now here what I've got is just a plastic bottle, and I went to a job recently and we confiscated one of the prong collars that was being used, so we put it inside there. So you see they are useful. You can make use of things like prong collars. You just stick them inside here, pop them inside your noise box, and they make a nice rattle. So again, we just drop some food in, let the dogs play about with it. Just gets them used to noises, gets them used to all kinds of things, and just, again, builds confidence. Other things that I do is when I go around with puppies is, you know, just random kids' toys, obviously. I'm not keeping these. I do have a grandson, okay? So my grandson has these when he comes round, and now I've got a new granddaughter. So these are just very, very random noises. So as you can see, just lots of different novel objects. And if the dogs are enjoying it, you know, just reward them, just pay them off, let them investigate. Okay. So these objects are novel. These are different. I've set one off. There you go. Wherever he is. So just random objects like that. But you can see with Rebel and Bliss, these objects just mean nothing. Good girl. I'll pop that out of the way. Nice little tune. Come then, pop it. So remember I said about this cushion? So you can see it's got a different sort of noise on it, and my dogs will just kind of wander all over it. So you can create things like balance paths. So if I get another object here, I can then just create objects for them to wander over and explore. Good girl. Good boy. So the more novelty you can add, and you see I'm just using very, very random objects. You don't have to go to massive expense, okay? But it just makes a bit of noise. And when they get on it, you can start almost doing some, I can't move it when you're on it, Rebel. But if the pups are on it, you know, you can start moving it. Can't move it that far. They can just get used to all these novel noises. Good girl. Good girl. Here you go. And then we can move that out the way. Then just using things like cardboard box. Now, these are just wonderful things before you obviously have your recycling day. So you can just pop this on the floor. And I can just, again, just throw some food in. If you bought the big bags of dog food, before you throw them away, just cut some slots in the bottom of it and do this with one of your bags of dog food. You know, it's just a way of getting them to go into these spaces with that little bit of confidence. So all we're trying to do is to shape something that says our world has all these weird and wonderful things in, but they can explore it. You can make it even more complicated. I mean, I could put this box and close the lid a little bit and then put this box inside that box. So make it a bit harder for them. So we get this box, pop some food in it, pop it in there, and then we just go, there you go. Yep. I'm just gonna pop some food in. Just let them plough in and go and investigate. Good boy. Okay, so just nothing expensive. I mean, I do have some of the sort of more expensive side of equipment, but you can see here I'm just using, I mean, this is, not saying you will have one of these, but this is an old back into an archery board. So just foam padded. Good girl. Okay, pop that out of the way. If you do want to go to the upper end of equipment, obviously things like this can be really, really good. This is a Fitpaws peanut. And as you can see, why do I love these things? I mean, these are great because you can see how it wobbles. So she has to hold her core on. So once we sort of get them on, Rebs, hop it up. Come, up. So once we hold them in position and it wobbles slightly, they have to use their core muscles. Good boy, Bliss. Rebs, come on, hop it up. Good boy. Good boy. Go on then. Stick him up. Good boy. Now, what I will tell you is just things like this. I mean, 5-10 minutes of this is probably the equivalent to a 45-minute walk. Okay? So because they're having to expel energy and just holding themselves. Bliss, hop it up. Good girl. Hop it up. Let's pause up. Sit. Sit. You're going to sit. Good boy. Come on then. Pause up. Good boy. Good girl. So then as it moves and wobbles, but you might have a human silicone one. I mean, these are obviously designed for dogs, so they've got a few little pimples on that makes it a little bit easier to put them on. But there you go. And who doesn't love a snuffle mat? Okay. So just a mat with flaps of material on. Some fantastic people on Facebook actually make some of these. You can get them designed to your living room, matching colours, have them in a mound, have them flat, you name it. You can pretty much get a snuffle mat for whatever you need. I use snuffle mats, licky mats. Now, a licky mat is just a flat silicone base. And what I do with Bliss is get her kibble, boil the kettle, cup full of kibble in a dish, boil the kettle, pour boiling water over it, let it turn to mush, mash it all down, smear it over a licky mat, and now she has that frozen. So that will keep her occupied for, half an hour the other day on a little small licky mat. Rebel had a larger one, took him about 45 minutes, and then he may have a stuffed Kong. Again, I've now got mine on to frozen, but if you are going to go that way, don't go straight for a full-on frozen one, okay? So don't go and put it solidly frozen because you might make it too difficult. So the idea is a little bit of frozen, then a little bit of loose kibble or even some nice cheese behind it. And then once you've done that, then you can gradually build up the size of the frozen. So I'm just going to come back and we'll have a look, see if we've got any comments or any questions about anything that we've done. Okay. So anyone got any questions on just some of those general enrichment ideas? And we'll come back, we'll go through a few more as well. So you can see doing stuff like this with the puppy, even at 8 weeks old, is so useful. And what I wouldn't be doing is obviously that that's lent up against one of my raised platforms might be a little bit too high, because we don't want the puppy to be falling off. So we don't want them jumping any more than probably sort of wrist height. So we don't want them jumping off anything that's higher than wrist height. So just simply wandering up and down things is great for them, different surfaces. And that's why you'll notice, you know, if you can sort of see the garden, we have a solid tyre tunnel or drainage tube tunnel. We have raised platforms with AstroTurf on. We have a ramp which is made of concrete. We have sleepers, and there you can see. So we have sleepers with stones in them. We have a patio area. We have stones. We have a doggy pool. Obviously, we have the big raised platform. Not suggesting for 1 minute that you have one of those, but if you notice over there, and there's Brutus and Satan over there. Brutus is currently on our A-frame, and believe it or not, that's my handiwork of sort of remoulding and repurposing a old picnic table. So, you know, you haven't got to go to masses and masses of expensive buying items. I mean, the Wendy house there was a donation from my good friend Jem over at Red Robin Dog Training. So she sort of brought that over to me as well. So there's so much that you can do around here. And then obviously in the distance, you can just see another raised platform and the second tyre tunnel, which is made of tyres. So there's lots of different surfaces in this garden for them to wander over and transition from one place to another. Okay, so there's so much that you can do. So if you do have any questions, I say particularly about puppy, one of the things that I would want people to do. Hi, Sarah. How's Mac doing? We miss Mac so much. It feels so weird not seeing him. So one of the best things you can do with your puppy, depending where you live, obviously. Now, if you live on a busy street or on a pathway to a park or where people may be walking with their dogs, one of the things you can do is just sit outside. If you've got a front step, or if you just take a picnic chair or something, and just sit outside, have your dog in your arms, just sat watching the world go by. Yes, for you, it's probably not going to be the most interesting thing going, but for your puppy, it's going to be invaluable. Okay, it's going to be one of the best investments you can do by just getting them to just experience the world. Cars go past, bikes go past, joggers go past, all the time things happening. Currently whining at you. Oh, bless him. Anyone who doesn't know, Sarah's got Mac, who comes to our daycare. He's called Caramac for a reason. He's our Caramac coloured lurcher, whippet. I always get it, lurcher. But he's very, very sweet. Yes, Rebel. So again, sat outside, just exposing them to the world. Walk to a local park, walk back. You know, only has to be sort of 5 minutes at a time. Use whatever you have available, but recycling bin is a great place for me to, and I kind of will reuse all my cardboard boxes probably 20, 30 times during the 2 weeks of the recycling collection. So it just comes out. And you know the doggy pool that I just showed you over there? What I will do sometimes is empty that of water, and then I'll just throw in all the cardboard boxes and everything, and just throw it all in there, and then throw their breakfast in, and just watch as everything goes flying all over the place. Okay, so hi, Jamie. So it's really, really good in terms of anything you can do to just build up overall confidence, random items, bottlenecks. So there's another great game you can do if you've got, I don't know if you're just gonna show you this. So down there, you can probably just see I have basically it's a jump. But what I do is I can raise that bar up to the highest level, and then with some string and some 2 litre plastic bottles, and you can probably just see Blister's tail because she's watching the sunlight go whizzing past, and tie some plastic bottles onto the bar, and then get them walking underneath it so they clang into the plastic bottles. So there is so much that you can do to build their confidence about so many things without having to leave your home. Okay. Bliss was, she went to my local park twice, I think, three times in the sort of 8 week, from 8 week to 16 weeks. She went to train station twice, and then she went, and then outside of that, I think she went to the Peak District once. Okay. Everything else we did pretty much in the home and outside the front of our house. So I say, anyone who's got a puppy, don't panic. Go on to the YouTube channel and have a look at the, there's about 60 videos there now of how to raise the perfect puppy, which is of how I raised Bliss. Just have a look at those. Just go through them, work through them. They'll give you plenty of ideas on what to do. Okay. So what we can do now when we look at general enrichment, you've already seen some of the games that we can do, so you can then just move that on and start getting more advanced and do so many different things. So just bear with me as I check. I can't see the screen. There you go. I think just move that up there. So we can go on to things like using cones and even scent work. Now obviously those who know and have seen Bliss know that scent work is something that Bliss really loves. So what we have is we have a drainage pipe and we have what we call a hot tin, which is still got gun oil in. It's quite old now actually, this one. And then what we do, we would pop this down, and then I'm just going to move the tin over there, and then she's got to try and find where the scent is. Yes, good girl. And what I do is I mix it up, because it normally can end up in one of those pots. So if I pick this up, pop this over here, sort of pop something in there, put that down, and you'll see that she will signal to it. Good girl. But do you need to go to the trouble of using a scent tin? No. You know, if you want to, you could just go, right, I've got some food here and I'm going to hide the food in there, and then they can have to go and find the food. So around your garden, you can data feed, you can just place food in all kinds of different places and just let them try and find it. So Bliss is currently over there sniffing, so she's trying to figure out where that food went. So she's found one. So again, I can just throw some more. And what this does is gets them using their nose. And I can't stress how important it is to let your dogs use their nose. It will get them way more tired than anything else. 41% of the dog's brain given over to sense of smell. It's their primary sense, so make use of it. And if you can put things on cue like sniffing and finding things, you know, your dog will go back inside. Bliss, after 10 minutes of scent work, and she's an English Springer Spaniel, will just go and put her head down and go to sleep. Bliss, come here, pop it, jump. Bliss, oh, she's interested in something. Come here, jump. Oh, she's not in a mood for jumping. What are you doing? Are you coming? Jump. Come on then, jump. There you go. Good girl. Well done. Good girl. So, how you can do scent work? I mean, we can use things like... Never bought so much DIY stuff since I was on my recent scent course. And it's just got a tin in the top. And then as I hold it into different positions, and then I feed through that top one. So again, just lots of different objects. Good girl. Good girl. That you can do. If you want to start doing things like object wrapping, just some random cones. So we can start with one cone. Yes, Bliss. There's no treat in there. We can just pop it up like that. Bliss, come here. Right, and just lure them round. Go, zoom. Yes. I need some. This is when you train with two dogs. It's kind of a little bit strange. Or you can just go to, obviously, just doing some weaves. Bliss has different ideas. Right, Rebel, come here. Hop it up. Right, sit. Stay there. Good boy. Right, Bliss. Hello, monkey. Come here. And just go, yep, come on. Come on. No, that was pants. So Bliss is like, I don't need the cones. Dear Bliss. Right, Rebs, hop it up. Sit. Boy. Right there. Come, Bliss. So, Blissy. And I don't think it's Bliss that's pants. I think it's my luring that's pants, to be honest. Good girl. So I'm just turning around too soon. But you get the idea. You can just whiz around, do different things. Are you going to do it, Rebs? Come on. So you're just as bad. It's got to be me. It's got to be me. It's got to be me. Or just get some better cones as well. As you can see, Bliss is just your typical English Springer Spaniel. Like, I don't care what's in my way, I'm just going through. Rebs. So you're just as bad, Rebel. Come. Come. Yay, good boy. So, other games. Just move these out of the way. So for enrichment, for getting dogs to run about, anyone who is on the Sexier Than a Squirrel challenge will have seen some of these games. So what I'm going to do with this, because doing this with two dogs is going to be a nightmare, so just bear with me. So don't know if anyone's got any questions. Okay, so just bear with me a second while I just go and pop one away, because otherwise it'll be carnage and I'll end up on my backside, I think. Good boy, Rebs. And we'll keep young Bliss out. So again, just very, very simple, fun games. Very easy to do. Let's pop that out of the way. Ready? Get it. Yes. 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 Middle. Good girl. Walk. Good girl. Good girl. Good girl. Good girl. Good girl. Good girl. Yes. Oh, you got it. Sit. Good girl. Okay, then we can just go to pause up game. Yes, good girl. Send her away. Oh. What are you doing, monkey? Yes, good girl. So you see, no nagging, no pestering, just wait for her to come back and re-engage with the object. Yes, good girl. Good girl. Come on. Lissy. Yes, good girl. Something I've not done with her. I'm just trying to get her to start pivoting. Oops. You see what I mean? Just stand it, just to hold it in situ. Oops. But you can see how, even with that falling over, she's still got that confidence to just keep coming back to it. It doesn't panic her. She just comes back again. That's why doing so much to do with confidence for me is better than thinking I got to get my dog into a puppy class where it's going to meet six other puppies and they're just going to play like ballistic lunatics. That's not good for your pup. Good girl. Ready? Go get it. Good girl. Go get it. So what we can do then is obviously go back to the cones, which was, you know, bit of a strange, but what we're going to do is just going to pop it around, and what I wanted to try and do is to learn to go around them. So I'm going to go right, Bliss, zoom, and I'm going to add the word zoom. So zoom, good girl, zoom, yes, good girl, zoom, good girl, zoom, good girl, zoom, good girl. So I'm going to try and do it without a treat this time. Zoom, yes, good girl. So you can see nothing in my hand. Zoom, good girl. Then I go further away. Zoom, yes, good girl. Zoom, yes, good girl. Zoom. So she says she's just losing interest there. So don't worry about it. I'll just come back again. See whether she wants to have another go. Zoom. Yes, good girl. Zoom. Nope. So if she breaks, then just no reward. I don't worry about it. I just can kind of just have a non-event, but I just don't reward her for getting it wrong, but nothing bad happens. Zoom. Yes, good girl. And then go back to rewarding. Zoom. Yes, good girl. Good girl. Okay. So, hello, madam. Sorry, girly. Right, let's just switch that around a little bit. Okay. So, hopefully, that's given you a few ideas on what you can do with your puppy, what you can do with your dogs in general while we're in this lockdown situation. There is no need to panic. You do not need to worry. You just need to be careful. Your puppies can go out, but just don't get them, you know, you don't want to be going to a nature reserve. You don't want to be going to a park where there's going to be lots of dogs and urine and feces around and the remnants of feces whereby, you know, your dog will want to go and investigate that. So that's the important part, is to keep them away from that. Know where they are, but you can, as I say, carry them, expose them to things. I know we're not supposed to, you can't sort of necessarily go in the car, but what you could do in your car is put them in the car, drive off, you drive reverse on. We're not going anywhere, but we are getting them used to the car. So the great thing about doing this again with the car is we're not putting them in the car like we normally do when we just need to get them to go somewhere. So actually you can spend a lot of time just getting them in the car, playing games with them in the car, having fun with them in the car, drive forward on your drive, reverse back on, if you happen to have that, or if you need to, you know, drive around the block. I don't want to get slated for saying it's an unnecessary journey, but I don't see that training a pup to be habituated and socialized to a car is actually an important life skill. So it's not necessarily an unnecessary journey, it's part of the training process. And because we have that 3 weeks to 16 week window, you know, it is important that we start doing some of these things now. Okay, so anyway, hope that's been useful, hope that's been helpful. A few tips on games. If you have got any specific puppy questions, then just pop them in the comments below. And if you've got any general dog questions, then just pop them in as well. But I have two separate play, well, I have three playlists now on my YouTube channel. So we have Bliss, How to Raise the Perfect Puppy, and I'll put all the links on this post as well. So How to Raise the Perfect Puppy, dog training videos, and then we have the 25 Days Sexier Than a Squirrel Challenge. We're currently on today is day 13. So we did day 12 yesterday. Yes, I think that's right. So that's still going at the moment. So those videos are on there as well. And I'll put all the links to that YouTube channel on there as well. And then for anyone who's interested, if you want some specific dog training, obviously for me, I am available to do sort of one-to-one consults over Skype, WhatsApp, Zoom, Messenger. We do have a brand new dog training course, which is the Good Dog Level 1 course. Really great course, teamed up with some fantastic trainers to be able to deliver this. And also alongside that course, I've got a specific Facebook group that is supporting anybody that's on it. And then coming out very soon, we're launching a whole range of mini courses. So the idea is that rather than have to buy a big course, there's all these little bite-sized chunks. So I've got two at the moment where we've done disengagement and we've just finished filming the door protocol. So hopefully they'll be out and available very soon. And they go through the step-by-step process for solving those specific problems. Okay, so the door protocol one goes through noises, walking to the door, front door, someone being outside the front door, and then bringing the person in. So it's a real step-by-step guide to show you how to teach your dog to be able to cope with that. So thanks for joining us. Hope you found it useful, and I'll see you very soon. Have a good day.